This is Noise from the Cranium. My name is Doug, and in this episode, I'm going to conclude my interview with guitarist Paul Rudolph. After Rudolph left the Pink Fairies in the summer of 1972, he gigged briefly with Uncle Dog.
I started playing with a band called Uncle Dog, with Carol Grimes.
Uncle Dog didn't last long.
We decided Uncle Dog wasn't going anywhere, so we decided to do a farewell gig outside at this, you know, venue.
That's where he was introduced to Brian Eno.
At the end of the gig, John Porter came up and he said, I'd like to introduce you to somebody. Yeah, this is Brian Eno. He's just left Roxy Music and he's doing his first solo album. And, you know, we shook hands and Brian said, how would you like to play bass on my album?
Paul ended up playing on 4 Eno albums and he had no qualms about telling me what it was like to work with him.
Best experience I've ever had in the music business.
Really?
Yeah. The guy's a brilliant facilitator.
He still has some of the original gear from those sessions.
That synthesizer right there, which is an original 73, extremely rare, would sit beside his in Island Records in the studio. And we'd be plugging shit in and out and coming up with all this other stuff. And the engineer would go, what are you guys doing? You know, don't worry, as long as nothing starts to smoke. Right.
Eno's first solo album, Here Come the Warm Jets, was recorded in September 1973 and features Paul Rudolph and Robert Fripp on dueling lead guitars on the track Babies on Fire. Of course, prog geek that I am, I had to ask him about that.
It was easy. Two people played the same sort of genre of solo. One guy down on the neck, the other person up on the neck. On mixing boards, you've got cut switches. You just go like this with the cut switches. So people would go, wow, that guy's so fast to go from there to there, right?
The next Eno album he played on was Another Green World. On the song I'll Come Running, he played bass, snare drums, bass guitar, and assistant castanet guitar. Paul explains what that is.
And on one of his tracks, there's castanet guitars.
I'll come running to tie your shoe. I'll come running to tie your shoe.
People listen to that castanet. How did they do that, right? So I'm sitting, there's a bench behind the control room in the Big Island studio, and I've got my black Les Paul, which is sitting there, sitting here. I'm doing the chords, and the body's over here on Eno's lap. I'm doing the chords, and he's got two pencils bouncing him off the strings to get the rhythm he wants. And stuff like that, right?
Thinking outside the box.
Oh, yeah.
Paul talks about Eno's ability to get unique performances from the musicians.
I mean, I've got on Brian's third album, because I did 4 albums with him. He's saying, I got this great idea for this chord sequence. Everybody practiced. There was me. I was playing bass. Percy Jones was there on bass. Phil Manzanera on guitar. Phil Collins on drums. So, okay, spend a half an hour going through these chord changes. So everybody, you know, practicing away together, right? To get it, trying to get a feel for this thing. After half an hour, Eno says, tea break. Anyway, we come back after the tea break and Eno says, now, everybody has to pick up the instrument they're the least familiar with and do a take.
And how he ousted Phil Collins from the drum stool.
That same session with Phil Collins, everybody's playing away as is on a different song on that album. And Eno keeps walking into the studio and taking cymbals away from Phil Collins. Then he starts taking his drums away and finally Phil says, what are you doing? Eno says, you're playing too much. I need simple, simple drums. And he said, let's have a break. So we have a break and I went into the control room and I said to Eno, I said, I don't want to blow my own horn. I said, but I was drum major in the Elphinstones High School marching band. I said, I'm not a drummer, but I have good time. Eno says, oh, OK, Hey, you go sit at Phil's drums. Sends the backing track down. I play the drums. And as soon as I finish the drums, I hear through the headphones, you just made another $400. So that's one of my big claims to fame is I stole a drum session from Phil Collins.
That's great.
And it's on the album.
He was also a pioneer in the use of tape loops.
At one point, before there was tape loop machines and that sort of stuff, in Ireland's biggest studio, the control room's pretty big, we had a tape loop that was probably 40 feet going around jugs of milk acting as capstans, and the whole tape loop is going around on these machines, and I'm going, what the hell's he doing? Then he's got Robert Fripp plugged into the mixing board, and that was the first, because Fripp's really good at playing along with himself when he gets something going, right? Long before loopers.
In 1973, Rudolph also did some studio work for Robert Calvert, who had been Hawkwind's lyricist and occasional lead vocalist. He worked on his solo album, Captain Lockheed and the Starfighters. What it was like to work on that project.
Well, if you can imagine the energy, because we were recording that at Air Studios in London, right? And there was one day in particular, says, okay, let's get here early. Arthur Brown's coming. So Air Studios, and I mean, the place ain't cheap, right?
Well, that's
Arthur
George Brown Martin's, arrives. George Martin Studio, right?
Yeah. Arthur Brown arrives. Everybody's got to leave the studio and go to the control room. Because Arthur Brown needs to put his cushion on one of the speaker cabinets and clear the vibes in the studios. Spends half an hour meditating. But as the session gets rolling, the guy's an incredible singer. Jesus, he can sing, huh. Right? But there's Arthur Brown. Everybody's in one spot. Arthur Brown, Brian Eno, George Martin heard this was going on. So he showed up, right? And me. And Adrian Shaw I think he had one of the first big Moog things. And it was like just the energy of these people together was like incredible.
I asked him if it was difficult working with Calvert.
For me, it was easy.
Yeah.
Because I didn't have it. There was no, you know, he was an eccentric country gentleman in a way.
Okay.
And for some reason, we really hit it off.
The Hawkwind connection surfaced again in 1976. Rudolph recorded one album with the band, Astounding Sounds, Amazing Music. He got the gig when bassist Lemmy got busted at the Canadian border.
My beatnik friend Ted and I had a free house in Shepherd's Bush. He was a antique Ferrari restorer. And I didn't actually have a gig at the time, and Doug Smith phoned me up and he said, what are you doing? I said, I was just helping Ted take the mufflers off this Ferrari. He said, well, Lemmy just got busted and we need somebody to finish the UK, the US tour. Can you be ready to go tomorrow? I said, sure. And that was it.
It was a fairly easy transition for Rudolph. Hawkwind and the Pink Fairies often gigged together, so he was familiar with the songs. And he was good friends with the band and with Lemmy.
And I mean, Lemmy and I were really good friends. Like, I was at the very first Motorhead gig where Lemmy had already had a leather jacket, inside pocket, big bag of speed, and he had a special little tube that came up, so he could look like he was sneezing, but he could take a hit of speed. All the Hell's Angels were there and stuff like that. And it's funny because after, you know, I mean, after that whole scene, you know, a lot of people still think that, you know, oh, Paul Rudolph took over from Lemmy, and, you know, they couldn't have been friends. Well, everybody was friends, right?
They may have all been friends, but it turned sour when Rudolph wanted more input into the musical direction of the band. I asked him if the band didn't like his suggestions.
Dave Brock didn't like that because it meant other people would get more royalties than him. When I played on Quark, Strangeness and Charm, the band went to Rockfield in Wales to record, right? So this is like my second year in Hawkwind. Myself, the sax player, and one of the two drummers made ourselves somewhat unpopular by saying, you know, how come one guy's getting all the publishing money here and stuff like that? The album got finished. Dave, one of the founding members of Hawkwind, was so upset. He had all of our tracks removed off the album and hired session musicians to redo it. But I thought, how bitter could somebody be to do that? And he did.
Did Brock replace all of his guitar parts?
The only one he couldn't redo, the only song on the album he couldn't redo, was the song I still get far and above the most royalties for, which was called Hassan Asaba, which was the Assassins of Allah, and it was all about oil money and the early, you know, thousands of years ago, Arabs eating hash and crawling through the desert with their knives in between their teeth to kill their enemies, right? Black Saddle Timber, 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 Black Saddle Timber. Death unto all you for bells in oil, kind of sold on cheek of the smoke. To a thousand and one nights in the loving garden of delights.
Why did he leave the guitar on that song?
Because he couldn't find anybody to, and I'm not saying this because I'm not an egomaniac, he couldn't find anybody to play guitar like I did.
By the end of the 1970s, Rudolph had had enough. I asked him if he loved his time in England.
Yeah. It was a really good time for, you know, 12 or 13 years. Mm-hmm. And then everything just seemed to fall apart with the drug use and people dying. And
he moved back to Canada and concentrated on another passion of his, cycling. He started a bike store in Gibson's in 2000, but kept his foot in the door of the music business. He had recorded a couple of albums with Twink as the Pink Fairies in the mid-90s, but Twink's dubious business practices brought an end to that partnership.
I did two CDs with Twink at my first home studio when I lived in Vancouver after moving back from the UK. He stiffed me on all the money from hundreds of CDs, right? So my nose got a little out of joint out of that because I think people should be fair to each other. Like in the Pink Fairies, we decided right away, everybody in the band was an equal partner in everything. There was no, I wrote the song and I get the money thing, right? Everybody shared everything, right? After Twink stiffed me on the CDs, he then started releasing all these horribly recorded bootleg tapes. And of course, nobody in the band saw any of the money. And then he was getting the merch made and never paying anybody. And we just decided, you know what? This just isn't working anymore. So he kind of exercised himself in a way with that kind of behavior.
With Twink out of the picture, Rudolph remains active with the Pink Fairies, recording Resident Reptiles in 2018 and Screwed Up in 2023. I asked him who he's got in this version of the band.
Me, Alan Davey, the bass player who took over playing bass in Hawkwind from me, and Lucas Fox, the original Motorhead drummer.
It's great to see that Paul still enjoys working on his music. My thanks to Paul Rudolph for sharing his fascinating stories and for being a gracious host and an all-around nice guy. I'd also like to thank Rob Frith from Neptune Records for inviting me along to the Q&A. I'm going to leave you with one of my favorite tracks that feature Paul Rudolph. Here's King's Lead Hat by Brian Eno with Paul Rudolph on bass. This has been Noise from the Cranium. Thanks for listening, and I'll catch you next time.